This presentation on the principles of psychrometrics, where we fit into the whole scheme of things in this class, is we're down here at the principles of psychrometrics. So we've gone through all these things of the review of thermal one, power systems, refrigeration systems, thermodynamic relations, ideal gas mixtures. Now this is going to play in. You're going to see a lot of this stuff that we did in ideal gas mixtures show up here in the psychrometrics piece here. But we're going to hone in right away on the next slide, telling what psychrometrics versus just any ideal gas mixture. So let's look at that. Get my laser pointer here. All right, so first of all, this is psychrometrics, not psychometrics. That little R right there is kind of important. The difference between these two is both of them are metrics. We're both looking at studying something and getting information about it. But with psychrometrics, we're looking at the study involving dry air and water. All right, so dry air and water. And specifically, the psychro comes from cooling. So we're looking at a lot of cooling-based systems when we're using dry air and water. And we'll see that as we get into the next presentation, especially. Where psychometrics is looking at the development and evaluation of psychological tests. So that happens for George Fox. It happens across the canyon in the Doctor of Psychology program, where they actually develop tests and looking at how they can evaluate those. The applications we'll see is obviously AC units that we have that we use in residential area, as well as an industrial scale with cooling towers. In this particular case, the nuclear application. But we also have other industrial processes where it requires close control of the vapor content within the air. And again, we'll get some experience with that. So what is this air we're talking about? What, specifically, we're going to look at moist air. We'll talk about moist air a lot with psychrometrics. And what that is we have different components of a mixture of air, and it's obviously the dry air. Dry air is a pure component. So as a pure component, we can go to table A22 and look at using those air values when we do our calculations. And the second component is water vapor. Again, water vapor we can look at as a pure component. And what you can see here on the left-hand side, so we have some molar amount and or mass amount of dry air and some molar or mass amount of water vapor. And then we can obviously come up with some mixture value total composed of our dry air and our water vapor. So those combine to create our moist air. As it says there, we can use the data tables. We're also going to assume ideal gas behavior. So we can use P equals, we can use that to calculate pressure in this case. So number of moles times the universal gas constant temperature divided by the volume. And on a mass basis, we can use a specific gas constant to use that in that calculation as well. But normally when we look at this, we're going to see this often, is that the number of moles that we have of the vapor is much, much smaller than the number of moles that we have of air in a given mixture. So while we do have vapor in moist air, the amount of it is very, very small relative to the amount of air that is in our dry air, that's in our moist air sample. So I want to make sure between those two, this is dry air here on the right-hand side, and this is vapor here on the left-hand side. All right, so when we look at moist air states, specifically on the vapor piece of things, we have partial pressure, right? We have the total pressure of the mixture. So say it's, probably what's around us right now is a 14.7 PSIA, absolute pounds per square inch. That would be the total pressure. Now, some small fraction of that, because the amount of vapor that's in the air is usually smaller than the air, is vapor. And so if we looked at the partial pressure, how much of that 14.7 is due to the vapor in the air, it would come out to be some value, and it would be at this point here, which is also at some given temperature. So we have some partial pressure that kind of gives us what line we're on here, what pressure line, and then we have some temperature. So we'd be at this point right here. Now, if we were able to add more vapor to the air, we would creep along this line. And if we maintain temperature, that's another key point. And again, we'll look at this more as we keep going, but I want to really give this kind of insight up front here. Maintaining temperature, and if we add vapor to the air, we'd move along the line this way until we hit a state where we're at saturation. So at saturation, the air can't hold any more vapor. And if we try to push any further to the left, kind of add more vapor, it will just condense. Right, it won't stay in vapor form. It'll move into liquid form. All right, and we can do that a couple ways. One way is to add more vapor. Another way is to cool. Again, we'll look at that more in the next presentation. All right, but again, partial pressure, it's a part of the total pressure of the moist air. So 14.7 PSI is the total pressure for our moist air, and we could have some partial pressure due to the vapor in that moist air. All right, so ways we can quantify how much vapor we have, or and dry air as well, as mole fractions. So we've looked at this already with the ideal gas mixtures and mixture processes. So mole fractions we can use. We can also use mass fractions. Again, we've looked at this already, so I'm not going to go into additional detail here. A new one for us, though, is humidity ratio. It's represented by omega, and another way you could say is specific humidity. And I'm going to go to another slide here and go a little bit more in depth with doing the calculation here. All right, so let's look into a little bit more depth of the humidity ratio, and that's our omega value. So we have here is our humidity ratio is a ratio, so it's the ratio of the mass of the vapor in the air divided by the mass of the dry air. So it's the two components that are in our moist air, the vapor, the mass of the vapor divided by the mass of the dry air. Now, remember that we can represent this. We're going to use ideal gas assumption when we do this analysis. And so if we change this over to partial pressures, the mass of the vapor would become, we can write this in terms of ideal gas, so that we got the molecular weight of the vapor times the partial pressure of the vapor times the overall volume that it's taking up divided by the universal gas constant times temperature. And we can divide that by kind of the same analysis on the bottom for the mass of the air. It's going to be the molecular weight of the air times the partial pressure of the air times the volume divided by the universal gas constant times the temperature. Now you can see a lot of commonality here, right? These terms are going to cancel, and we're left with just the molecular weight of the vapor times the partial pressure of the vapor divided by the molecular weight of the air times the partial pressure of the air. Now if we introduce here a little bit of an equation that's kind of obvious, hopefully. So we're going to introduce for the partial pressure of the air is equal to the total pressure minus the partial pressure of the vapor. All right. And we plug in for the molecular weights. We come up with 0.622 times the partial pressure of the vapor divided by pressure, total pressure minus the partial pressure of the vapor. So again, this 0.622, that's due to this ratio here of our molecular weights of the vapor in the air. And then our equation here comes from our partial pressure of the vapor over the partial pressure of the air, where we substituted for partial pressure of the air. The reason we do that is because the total pressure is going to be usually readily available, and the partial pressure of the vapor is something that we're interested in, so we'll do that calculation rather than keeping this partial pressure of the air. All right, so that's our humidity ratio, and this is pretty important because a couple things. One, we can solve for this value, and we'll use that a lot. We could also solve for the total pressure, and we can solve for the partial pressure of the vapor. We'll be solving for all three of these, so this is a very good equation to have in your repertoire as we move forward in solving the example problems. All right. So let's go back to the previous slide to see other ways that we can represent moist air. All right, so we can talk about relative humidity. And the definition for relative humidity is the ratio of the mole fraction of vapor in the mixture divided by the mole fraction of the vapor, what it would be if it was saturated, saturated moist air at the same mixture, temperature, and pressure. So on that previous plot that we showed, we had the TS diagram, vapor dome, right? And it had temperature going across like this, and we had some pressure contour like that, and then we had this value here and this value here. It's those two values. So here we had some partial pressure of the vapor, and this is partial pressure of the vapor at saturated condition. So that's another way we can write the relative humidity. So not just in terms of mole fraction, but also in terms of partial pressures. So it could be the partial pressure of the vapor divided by the partial pressure of the vapor when it's at saturated conditions, or saturated vapor, right? What that pressure is. And again, it's at the mixture
mixture, temperature, and pressure. And so the reason I'm highlighting mixture is that this temperature and pressure, right? Temperature kind of makes sense because it's constant temperature. We follow this dashed line across. The pressure, you might be like, well, the pressure is changing. This is the mixture pressure. So that's the pressure of the moist air, not the pressure of just the vapor or pressure of the dry air. It's the pressure of the moist air. So again, these are the mixture, temperature, and pressure when we look at those two values. All right, so that's something we can relatively easily find, at least partial pressure under saturated conditions from the table. And this one we're going to use in the example problem so you get a taste of how it's used right away.
So one of the ways we can measure relative humidity is by using a hygrometer. So a hygrometer is kind of a somewhat crude example presented here. We have this sensing element where it's got this piece here on the end. And what happens is it'll take a single sample and it'll collect the vapor that's in the moisture, absorbs into some chemicals, and the chemicals are weighed because they know the initial mass that they had, the chemicals, then it's weighed for the additional water vapor that was absorbed. It can also do continuous readings as there's some resistance or capacitance type sensors as well. And what they measure is the electrical characteristics that change due to the relative humidity. So you can see here, at least on this particular display, you get some temperature value and then some relative humidity value. All right, and so we'll get a chance to use the relative humidity on our example. So be sure to watch that video. We won't use the humidity ratio right away, at least for this first example, but we will get into it a lot as we go into the future presentations. All right, so thanks for your attention. And if you have any questions, let me know.